Hello and welcome you all to another lecture, and thanks for coming. So today we're going to see something which is actually very peculiar, at first sight, but it's actually quite beautiful at the same time, because you look at that formula and you think, wow, right? Where did that come from? What we're going to see here is that it comes very naturally, and it comes very naturally and as elegantly as they come. So what we are primarily going to discuss today is how do we actually exponentiate matrices. So before that, let's talk about this question: why do we need to exponentiate matrices? Well, for a start, consider you have any kind of let's say second order differential equation. Let's say b squared, or let's say b squared a by b squared is let's say some case a. It's not the usual simple harmonic equation, but it can be of this form or of any form whatsoever, and usually you can represent solutions of second order differential equations using a superposition of exponential solutions. So the solution can be k of t is some, let's say, some constant, let's say, so k is here, and g is there, so let's say g times, e of, anything, let's say minus, plus xt plus, some g1, let's call it g1, this is g2, this is minus xt, and everything over there is a matrix. So, if A is a matrix, everything in this equation will have to be a matrix. So, so when we are dealing with problems, where we have a coupled set of differential equations, right? So then, it is very instructive to form a matrix form of those equations, and obviously, when you form the matrix form, then you will have to get the exponentials. And as a matter of fact, which I know many of you will be aware, second order differential equations are everywhere. For a start, Newton's second law, right? That force is mass times acceleration, g squared x by dt squared. Basically this thing is everywhere, right? And then you have Schrodinger's equation and stuff like that. So not as clearly as in Newton's laws, but at least in Schrodinger equation it is way more clear, because in quantum mechanics we are dealing with operators, and in operators operators be like matrices, right? Because they act upon something. So when I'm dealing with the time dependent Schrodinger equation, I h bar d psi I dt equaling E psi, right? So this comes about by the by acting the Hamiltonian operator on the wave function, and obviously the very fundamental solution of this equation will be psi is equal to some constant, let's say psi naught times e to the minus e over h bar, and if e is dependent on time, then this will be the integral of et dt, and if not, then it will simply be et times e times t, right? But again, we know that that energies can be represented by Hamiltonians and stuff like that. So you'll have to then represent the exponential of a Hamiltonian operator, and a Hamiltonian operator comes in the form of a matrix. So again, matrix exponential is very important, at least in physics. It's also very important in stochastic calculus. It is way more important in stochastic calculus when you're dealing with random walks, when you're dealing with Markov processes, and hence, as stochastic calculus is basically everywhere in financial calculus and quantitative finance, it is very important in the fields of stock exchanges and stuff like that. So it's basically everywhere. So it's very important we know how to exponentiate matrices. So how do we go about exponentiating matrices? Well,
we can do one thing, which is, you know, just use the Taylor series expansion. Because, you know, when I'm talking about the Taylor series expansion of, you know, any, you know, e to the x, then I have 1 plus x over 1 factorial plus x squared over 2 factorial and stuff like that. And this thing fits the bill, right? Because, you know, if x is a matrix, then obviously I can take, you know, I can make the square of x. You know, I can take, you know, x cubed as bill and stuff like that. And you know, in principle, given a matrix x, you know, I can calculate everything about it. You know, everything about its, you know, exponential using the Taylor series expansion. Right. That's one way. But then consider this. And this problem is, you know, consider you have not only one, you know, matrix exponential, you know, but then you have, let's say, two matrices, A and B. And what you want to compute is, what is E times some lambda A times B times, you know, multiplied by B times, you know, multiplied by E to the minus lambda A. And as A and B are matrices, obviously, you cannot just write, you know, this is just E to the lambda A times e to the minus lambda a, that is e to the 0, and you won't there be. You cannot write that because when you're talking about matrices, you have commutations, and you know. So there, you know, from the first side itself, you know, considering that those are matrices, you will have very peculiar representation for their exponentiation. So So how can you actually go about calculating this? One method will be to you know, expand e to the lambda I and e to the minus lambda I in the Taylor series expansions and take the thing out. And that can work out, that will work out. But we will go through a different method. We will consider that this whole thing is some function of lambda. You know, it's not a priori that lambda is a constant or something like that. At least in the variables of A and B. So let's just consider that this thing over here is some function of lambda. One property that is clear in the first set itself is that this promises to be a smooth function. Smooth function in the sense that it is infinitely differentiable. Hence, we can represent it in a Taylor series format. And you know, the most easiest Taylor series format will be around zero. So this is a given that this thing can be represented as f lambda being f of 0 plus f prime being the first differential of f at 0 times, you know, lambda and 0 plus f double prime at 0 lambda squared over 2 factorial, and you see the pattern, right? This thing is possible for this because this is, you know, infinitely differentiable. This is smooth regular function. Now let's go about calculating these things because, you know, we just have to calculate these things over here now. So df by d lambda. So for df by d lambda. So firstly, we'll go, you know, term by term, we'll go by differentiating these things out. So b and a are constants here, right? So the first term will be differentiated, a will come down, so we have a times e to the lambda a times b to the minus lambda a. Second term will be differentiated, but now b will come before a because b is before e to the minus lambda a. So we will have plus e to the lambda a b a minus a, right? E to the minus lambda a. This thing will be now one thing is this, that we are calculating it at 0, so lambda equal to 0. We can just set lambda equal to 0, so these things will, you know, e to the lambdas will cancel out because lambda equal to 0 will give us 1. So we will have a b minus b a, and again, as they are matrices, it is not generally true that a b is equal to b. So we will have a commutator here. Basically, the first differential is a commutator of a and b. Right. Now, what will be the case for the second differential? Let's go over that, shall we? Obviously. F lambda equals to, you know, lambda 0, and F lambda is the lambda in B to the minus lambda A. Now for B square F over D lambda squared, again, here we will go again term by term differentiation. So, now, firstly this thing will come down. So, we already have an A over here. So, what we can do is we can take the A's away. If you like. So, this will be A. It's another A coming down equal to lambda A. B equal to minus lambda A. Right. Then we have another A, but this time the A is behind that now. So that will come to later on. But we have this thing over here. So we do the B A times minus B A, and actually this will stuck out with both of them. So lambda A equal to minus lambda A. So and then after that, this thing will come, after that, because e to the minus lambda will come as after being that. So again, we will have these commutators, but this time the order will be reversed. So e to the lambda A, B e to the minus lambda A, minus B, A e to the lambda A, minus lambda A. Now you have this thing. So now we again lambda equal to 0. We want to calculate it at that point. So you will have A times AB minus BA minus AB minus BA times A. So basically, this is the commutator of the commutator of A with the commutator of A and B. So this is A and B. Now you see the pattern, because now if you just keep on doing this thing for D group F by D lambda cube and stuff like that, for the third derivative, evaluate it. And 0, this will be, you see the nesting of it. This will be A, B, and this will keep on going in that way. So now, we reach at this conclusion that this thing over here, this power series over here is, first term is F of 0, so F of 0, has to be B. So we have f of lambda being b plus, so lambda times f prime of 0 over overall factorial. So that tells the commutator of a and b. So lambda times a and b commutator, then lambda squared over 2 factorial times the commutator of a and a and b, plus lambda cubed over 3 factorial a. This thing over here, and it just keeps on going. And this is the representation of this thing over here. A good thing to note is if instead of b we would have had e to the b, it would not have made much of a difference, because still that would have been a constant in the eye of f, in the eye of f lambda and all the differentiations. So if we would have had e to the b rather than b, then everywhere where we have b, we would have had e to the b. And this beautiful series over here, this beautiful and peculiar series over here is known as Hadamard's lemma. This is the thing. And to tell about
and to tell about its importance in different fields of physics and mathematics. You know, this is the cornerstone.
Plus cosine of the D, yeah.
This is the cornerstone of, you know, a lot of the formulas in this field, you know. Wien's canonical form of the commutation relation came out of this. And the Zeisenhaus formula, which is for the addition of matrices as an exponential, that also came out of this. Then, you know, the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula, which is used in a lot of applications in quantum field theory, came out of this. So, you know, this is everywhere. And, you know, this is something which should be taught in, you know, usual linear algebra courses, but, you know, it has been some kind of a miscellaneous thing. So that's why I wanted to cover this thing, because it does not deserve to be a miscellaneous thing. It is such beautiful. So I hope you learned something great today. I hope you learned something new today. And if you like what you learned, please give this video a like, share and subscribe and comment if you like to. And see you next time.